Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
This morning. It's great to see this crowd that we have today. I think me and Ryan were just talking about this might be the most people we've ever had in this building. It comes to work together, which is great. This is the way, you know, we pictured it when we first started coming to be where, wait a second, we don't got enough seats, which is great. That's a great problem to have.
That's right.
And we'll work on that kind of a problem. That's for sure. So, this morning it's great to have us all together here, together as Christians and as loved ones, as a family, that we can come together to worship God and His Son. So, this morning, to get us started, I thought I would read some from John 6. And this talks about Jesus telling the people around Him that He is the bread of life. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth hath eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread which cometh down out of heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down out of heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. Yea, and the bread which I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. Here Jesus is telling the Jews around Him, you had your fathers ate manna. God gave them that, but they still died. But I've come that you can have life and have it abundantly here, but have eternal life. And He said, I come and I'm giving myself for the world. What a beautiful thought this is. He's talking about bread here, which we all got to have to live. And here He brings it very simply into our lives. He is what we got to have to live. He is Jesus. So let's get started this morning. We're going to sing, Come Let Us All Unite to Sing.
Come let us all unite to sing, God is love. Let heaven and earth their praises bring, God is love. Let every soul from sin away, each in his heart sweet music make, and sing with us for Jesus' sake, for God is love.
Our next song will be All the Power of Jesus' Name. And after this, Jerry will lead us in a opening prayer.
All hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall, bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at his feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and praise him, Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and praise him, Lord of all.
Jerry.
Father in heaven, we humbly come unto you at this time, recognizing that you indeed are the Lord, our Lord, and that we owe all owe praise and glory to you. Father, we thank you for the grace that you have shown to us. We thank you for your Son that died that we might have that home in heaven with you. Father, as we go through this hour of worship to you, we pray that our hearts will be turned to you, that we'll all recognize that we are here at an opportunity to learn from your word. Father, help us to grow, help us to all be stronger, help us to increase our faith, and that we might worship you properly. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Our next song will be I Know That My Redeemer Lives, one of my favorite songs. And this morning Ryan's going to talk about faith in his sermon, and this song demonstrates that, our faith. We know that our Redeemer lives. That's why we're here.
I know that my Redeemer lives and ever prays for me. I know eternal life he gives from sin. I know.
years, and we could probably debate 1 or 2 years forth and back on that. And then In the Acts 20 chapter in verse 7, we see that the saints met on the first day of the week to break bread. And I believe they're meaning this, to get together and have this. And it makes sense because Christ was raised on the first day of the week. The day of Pentecost, which is essentially the birth of the church, was on the first day of the week. And the saints met on the first day of the week. And so that's what we're doing. And we're talking about examples and inferences and all that this morning in Bible class. And so that's why we're here. We're here to worship and to remember Christ. It reminds me of another story that's in the Old Testament, though. A story of Abraham. And Abraham was a very unique character, of course. And we know that later in his life, he was promised that he would have a son. And through his lineage, essentially, all nations would be blessed, meaning that eventually Christ would be born, and he blesses us because of that. But a very interesting thing happened after God promised him this son to come. Then it took quite a while. He was very old. Sarah was very old. The son comes. His name is Isaac. And then Christ said, the father said, I want you to sacrifice your son. And so Abraham just got up the next day and went about doing that. And we ponder what that could have been like or whatever. Very difficult to kind of figure that one out. But they were going along, and Isaac said to Abraham, my father, and he said, yeah, here, my son. And he said, behold, I see the fire, and I see the wood, and where's the lamb? And then Abraham said something very interesting. He said, God will provide for himself the lamb. And you can even extrapolate to a point where you say God himself provided himself the lamb later. He provided the lamb for Abraham, but he provides himself as the lamb for us. And so, and that's so that we don't have to die in our sins. And that's a great price that we cannot pay. This morning we were in 1 Corinthians, and I'll be there again in chapter 11. The Corinthians had a lot of issues, a lot of problems, one of which was how they were conducting this remembrance. And it wasn't so much that they were, that it was a meal, because I think a lot of it was a meal. The Passover was a meal. But it's how they conducted it. It was out of order. They were not waiting for each other. They were getting drunk. They were just having a big party over it. And that's not what its point is. And so that's when Paul straightened them out in verse 24 when he said, Christ did this. He said, here's my body with the bread. Here's my body. It's given to do this in remembrance of me. Here's this cup in the new covenant of my blood. This is as often as you do it, remember me. Now, is that the only reason we have communion, just to remember? Because we could remember without doing it. It's interesting that there's another portion of that that sometimes we overlook. And for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of Christ. So we're not only just doing this to remember, we're doing this to proclaim that we believe in a God, that we believe that he loved us so much that he sent his son to die, that he himself provided himself as the lamb. And so when we do this, we proclaim that belief, the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. And so as we do this, and we've done this now 103,428 times, wow, approximately, since Christ. And that actually seems like a small number to me. You'd think it'd be hundreds of thousands. It just goes to show you that it's really just recently in history that Christ died. So it's not so ancient ago that his promises are not being fulfilled. So we're going to pass out the bread, and then we'll pray for it, okay?
Shall we bow?
Father, we once again come before your throne on this first day of the week to remember Christ. We remember his body that was given. We thank you so much, Father, that this price was paid for us where we could not. He is our lamb. He is the lamb that was slain, an innocent lamb that has paid a price. We pray, Father, that we would always remember that and that we would always proclaim that. It is in his name that we pray.
Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we gather around your table once again, giving you all the praise and all the glory for everything, for giving us our Lord and Savior Jesus. We now have this remission of sin because of this great gift, this great sacrifice. We pray, Father, now as we partake of this cup, we remember Jesus hanging on that cross, and we just are so thankful that we have such a wonderful Savior. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Some of the important things to me are that our giving should be voluntary. It should be planned. We shouldn't regret it or begrudge it. It shouldn't be painful in any way. They say, give till it hurts. Well, it should never hurt how much you give. So that's the point. Your attitude is everything with regard to giving back to Christ. Not only our monetary means, that's easy, but it's our lives. We give our lives to him, and that's a lifelong pursuit. So if you would, let's bow in prayer. Father, the blessings in life are abundant. We have so much. We have more than enough. Our cup is always running over. We have an abundance, Father, and we pray that we would understand that that is a blessing from you. We live in a great nation. We live in a great community. We pray, Father, that you would continue to watch over us and bless us. Father, help us to have the right and proper attitude when it comes to living for you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
follow. But before Ryan gives us our lesson, we're going to sing wonderful words of mine.
Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words.
Exciting to be here with a truly full house. There's only a few seats here and there where even we could put somebody if we needed to. So it's pretty exciting to have as many people, visitors and our members here today as we have. That's encouraging to me, and I hope to all of you to be in the presence of our brothers and sisters and here to worship together. I have been started last week a series of lessons looking at the basics of the gospel, the basics of what it is to be a Christian, trying to sort of distill it down to the things that are, for lack of a better word, are necessary for you to be a Christian, are necessary for a Christian to believe in. And we looked last week at the basic core idea, which is that the gospel is meant to be a simple thing. The gospel is not intended to be something that requires a doctoral thesis before you grasp it, that requires you to do some things or believe some things that are very, very hard to come to, or that involve efforts that are very, very hard to make. The gospel is designed to be something that is simple. And one of the points that I made, and I think I want to remind you of this as we go through this study, my core default position when it comes to the question of whether something is a requirement for a Christian, whether something is necessary to be a Christian, is to default back to Paul's core principle, which is that it is for freedom that Christ has set you free. And I believe that it is not our job as Christians to go looking for things to bind on people, additional rules that people have to follow, but rather it is our job, it is our blessing to be able to look for opportunities for freedom in Christ. And so as we go through this series, I think you'll see that come out. I hope you'll see that come out anyway, since that's the core of what I'm trying to teach here. But today we're going to talk about faith. When it comes to core principles, faith is about as core as it gets, as we'll see as we go through this thing. And we're going to start in Matthew chapter 5, where we have the story of Jairus, the synagogue leader. And it says, one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. It's interesting because Jairus has faith. Jairus says, please come and put your hands on her. So he expects Jesus to be able to do this. He has faith that Jesus is able to do that. He has a trust in Jesus' power that we see here. It says a large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately her bleeding stopped and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. What we see here is a different, it's another kind of faith. It's faith, trust in faith. It's a faith that even goes a step beyond Jairus' faith because she just believes that if she can just touch his cloak, which by the way, some of the prophets in the Old Testament were known to do as they passed by the hem of their cloak, touched people and it healed them. So she didn't just make this up out of nothing. She had a reason to believe this, but she had a faith that said, if I can just do this one thing, and sure enough, it worked. So her faith isn't even just a trusting faith, it's actually a healing faith. She is healed because of this. But the scripture says that once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him, he turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? His disciples, they said, you see the people crowding against you, and yet you ask, who touched me? And what they're saying is, how do you expect to figure that out? You've got people all around you. Probably lots of people actually touched him. It was only one of those touches that was actually significant. So his apostles are, what are you, nuts? But Jesus, it says, keeps looking around to see who had done it. And then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, daughter, your faith is healed. You go in peace and be freed from your suffering. You can understand why she was afraid. She was afraid because she had presumed on his power to heal herself or to get the healing that she was seeking. She had done it in secret. And probably it was an embarrassing situation to have to explain, not just to Jesus, but to all the people who were around. And worst of all, she might be a little bit afraid that maybe he's going to take it back because she didn't do it the right way or something like that. But Jesus says, that's not how it works. You had faith and your faith healed you. It was his power, but it was her faith that actuated that healing. Go in peace. So there's no recrimination. There's no judgment for her faith. There's a recognition of the power of her faith that comes from Jesus here. The story goes on and says that while Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. Your daughter is dead, they said. Why bother the teacher anymore? Imagine this. Imagine what the Jairus was thinking. If just that woman had just stayed out of the way, we could have got there in time. If I had just gone sooner, we could have got there in time. His world is collapsing around him, and Jesus says to him, ignores what they've said. He says to him, don't be afraid, just believe. And we know, of course, that Jesus will go on to Jairus' house. He will raise his daughter from the dead, give him back to her. But I want us to focus on that phrase there. Don't be afraid, just believe. Because when it comes to Christianity, there is no attribute of Christians that are more fundamental to our existence than faith. The words belief and faith are sometimes used interchangeably. Sometimes they're used with a little bit of a nuanced difference. But for our purposes today, I'm using them pretty much interchangeably, at least in my title card here. Because for Christians, belief, faith, is the core of what we are. And you can't even be a Christian without faith. Over in Hebrews chapter 11, the Hebrew writer says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen, for by it the men of old gained approval. A little further down it says, and without faith it is impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. In other words, you can't go to God and ask for something if you don't believe that he exists. On one level, that seems obvious, right? You know? But on the other level, it's not so much. Actually, the philosopher, Christian philosopher, who made the argument that that you should believe in Jesus, or you should obey Jesus, and you should practice Christianity regardless of whether you actually believe it or not. And the theory goes like this: if you believe it, then you're going to be living what you believe, and you're going to get the rewards at the end. If you don't believe it, and you're right about not believing it, then there's no harm, no foul if you practice Christianity. But if you don't believe it and you practice it, at least you'll get the reward at the end. That's a terrible, terrible philosophy, and it's logically bankrupt, because faith is a necessity for a relationship with God. You can't cynically say, you know what, I'll do what God says. I don't really believe he exists, but I'll do what God says, just on the off chance that he really does exist. That's not the kind of follower that God is looking for. God is looking for people that are dedicated to him, people that have faith in his existence, and faith that he rewards those who seek him. He's looking for people with faith. So when I say that faith is central to being a Christian, I'm not kidding. You literally cannot be a successful Christian if you don't have faith. Faith in God's existence and faith in what God will do for you. Those are fundamental characteristics, fundamental necessities if we're going to be Christians. And it's important to recognize that faith is not the same thing as knowledge. Knowledge, knowing something is true, is distinct from faith. Now, there are places in the scriptures that talk about our faith helps us to know certain things. But when you get right down to it, faith is, it has an element of the unknown in it. We believe that God exists. I don't think any of us have ever actually talked to him personally, like in a direct actual interaction. None of us have seen him. None of us have touched him. We haven't, you know, smelled him or any of those kinds of things. We see evidence of him. We see in the scriptures God speaking to us, and we talk to him in prayer, but we've never had direct interaction with him. So faith, that element of uncertainty is there. And even people who did have direct interaction with him in the Old Testament and the New Testament, they still had to have faith because they weren't seeing all of it. They weren't seeing all of the picture of who God was or what God was doing. So faith is still a necessity even for those who directly interacted with it. There's got to be some element of the unknown. That's part of what Paul is talking about over in 1 Corinthians 13 when he says that faith and hope are going to pass away. They're going to pass away once God actually returns, because once God is there physically present, you don't need to have faith in him anymore. You just have to have the power of observation at that point. So faith is no longer necessary where knowledge becomes the reality. And then the other thing that Paul says here is you can't please God without faith. And that's really important, because that means that no matter what you do, even if it's exactly what God wants, if you don't have faith, you can't please him. That was the problem the Pharisees had. The Pharisees were trying to do exactly what God wanted, but they weren't doing it because of faith. They were doing it because they believed that if they followed the rules exactly right, it would force God to do what they want. And that's not faith, that's bargaining. And bargaining is not what God wants either. So when we understand that without faith it is impossible to please God, then we start to say, okay, so what is faith? What does that mean? And how does that work? And actually, we're going to go back to a passage we looked at last week, over in Romans chapter 3, where Paul says, but now, apart from the law of Moses, the righteousness of God has been manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all those who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation in his blood through faith. We see this idea over in the first part of this, the righteousness of God through faith. So faith somehow gets us access to the righteousness of God, faith in Christ Jesus. Not just faith in anything. I'm not faith in GM doing well in the stock market. That isn't going to get you any closer to God. Faith in Christ Jesus gets us righteousness somehow. And he continues and he talks about that his grace is given as a gift, and that leads to redemption in Christ Jesus. So there's a relationship, faith and grace and redemption. There's some kind of relationship there, and we want to explore what that is. And so we want to begin by understanding that Paul speaks over and over again about the righteousness of faith. And I don't mean of faith in the sense of the righteousness belonging to faith, but rather the righteousness that is produced by faith, the righteousness that comes by faith. Paul continues in Romans 4, immediately after the passage we just read, and he says, what then shall we say that Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh, has found? If Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. It says that in Genesis chapter 15. After Abraham has first obeyed God, and he's gone to the promised land, or to Canaan, and he's begun moving around, and he's had a variety of things happen to him, God at some point says to him, you're going to have an heir. It's not going to be somebody who's just vaguely related to you. You're going to have an actual son through Sarah who's going to be your child. And the scriptures say Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. So God credits Abraham's faith in him, Abraham's willingness to believe in him, despite the fact that everything doesn't look like that's going to happen. He's almost 100 years old. His wife is getting up there in age too. Neither one of them is at the point in a point to bear children. But God says it's going to happen and Abraham believes it. He has faith in him, and because of that, God credits that to him as righteousness. Paul continues and he says, now to the one who works, his wage is not credited as a favor, but as what is due. In other words, when you get done with a day of work and you go into the guy who runs the place and say, give me my wages, he doesn't say, ask nicely. Well, maybe he does, but you say, no, you owe me my wages. Give them to me or I'll go talk to a lawyer. And maybe you'll go right to the lawyer thing. That's me, I'm a lawyer. Anyway, you have the right to that because you earned it. But he says, that's not how it works with grace. That's not how it works with justification by God. He says, to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is credited as righteousness, just as David also speaks of the blessing on the man to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. David says, blessed are those whose lawless deeds have been forgiven and whose sins have been covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will not take into account. And you think about David for a second here. David saying those things, that's pretty significant. Because when we look at the life of David, you can ask the question, David is called the man after God's own heart. Do you think he was called that because he was so good at following all of God's rules all the time? No. David is the guy who committed adultery with a woman and then had her husband killed in a treacherous way in order to try to cover up the fact that he committed adultery with her and she was going to have his child. David is the man who called for a census of Israel that caused thousands and thousands of Israelites to be killed by an angel of the Lord until David repented and the Lord withdrew his hand. David was not perfect, but what David had was faith. And because of David's faith, he could say, even in a system that was driven by law, blessed are those whose sins have been forgiven. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will not take into account. And it was faith that led him to have that comfort, not the comfort of knowing that he followed all the laws. Paul continues and says, is this blessing then on the circumcised or on the uncircumcised also? For we say faith was credited to Abraham as righteousness. In other words, is this just for people who follow the law of Moses, or is this for people who are outside of the law of Moses and don't follow that law as well? Paul continues and he says, well, let's look at it. How was it credited? The credit that was given to Abraham of righteousness, was it credited while he was circumcised or uncircumcised? And the answer is not while circumcised, but while uncircumcised. Like I said, that statement, Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness, is stated in Genesis chapter 15. It's not until Genesis chapter 17, two chapters and a number of years later, that God establishes the covenant of circumcision with Abraham. So Paul says Abraham was righteous by faith before he was ever circumcised. And he says he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had while uncircumcised, so that he might be the father of all who believe without being circumcised, that righteousness might be credited to them, and the father of circumcision to those who not only are of the circumcision, but who also follow in the steps of the faith of our father Abraham, which he had while uncircumcised. So notice the commonality between the ones that are uncircumcised, the Gentiles, and the ones that are circumcised, the Jews, that he says are the spiritual heirs of Abraham. They have one thing in common, they both have faith. Now that faith led those Jews to be circumcised because that's what their law required. But that faith didn't lead the Gentiles to do that. Instead, it simply led them to Christ, just as it led the Jews who'd been circumcised to Christ. And it's that faith leading you to Christ that creates the justification, not the other stuff. Not the stuff that is the law of Moses, not the stuff of what the Gentiles had done in their past, but rather the faith in Christ. He continues, he says, for the promise, I'm sorry this is long, but this is kind of one of the most important treatises on faith in the entire Bible, so there's really no way to get around it. He says, for the promise to Abraham, or to his descendants, that he would be the heir of the world was not through the law, because the law of Moses didn't come about until hundreds of years after this anyway, but through the righteousness, he didn't say that, but for the righteousness of faith. For if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void and the promise is nullified. For the law brings about wrath. Where there is no law, there also is no violation. Whoops, sorry, that was the end of that passage. So it says that the promise to Abraham and his descendants, not just physical but spiritual, was that he would be the heir of the world. That was the promise God made. But it didn't come by the law, for one thing, because the law didn't exist when he made that promise to Abraham. And it wouldn't exist for a number of generations of his own children. So does that mean they're not covered by the law? That Abraham isn't? Of course it doesn't mean that. But rather the faith that they had. Abraham had it, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, so on and so forth. They had faith, and that faith brought them righteousness, even though the law hadn't even been written down yet. And by the same token, those of us who've never been under the law, who've never been subject to those rules and regulations, our faith also saves us, gives us righteousness. But he says, if the law is the only thing that makes you heirs, then faith is irrelevant. Faith wouldn't make any difference, and those people that were not under the law never got salvation, never got redemption, including Abraham, who's supposed to be the father of everybody. Because the law, all the law really does is bring about wrath. The law says, here's all the curses that happen if you don't follow the law. Okay, there's some blessings too, but guess what? None of you are going to actually follow the law, so only the curses actually apply. Wrath is the only thing that you get there. But he says, on the other hand, if there isn't the law, there's not a violation. And the point is that ultimately faith gets you outside of that law. Abraham was outside of the law, it hadn't been created yet. Gentiles are outside of the law, and faith is what is creating the relationship to God. There's a shorter version of this, and I could have gone to, except that it doesn't get into it in quite the same detail, over in Ephesians chapter 2, where Paul says, as for you, talking to these Gentile Ephesians, as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. You were dead in your transgressions and sins. You had no hope and you couldn't fix it. He says, all of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. This is, in many ways, a literal definition of the term dead meat. We were all flesh, and we were all dead. We were all dead meat. But, Paul says, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. Even though we were dead, even though we weren't doing the right thing, God made us alive in Christ by grace. You didn't earn it. You didn't work for it. You didn't do anything to fix the problem except respond to God's offer of grace by having faith in Him and in His Son, Christ Jesus. That's all you did. That's all that you did to get the grace of God. And it's better than that. That would be the healing kind of faith that we were talking about earlier. But actually it goes beyond that to what I would call transfiguring faith. It makes us better than we were because Paul says God raised us up with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages He might show the incomparable riches of His grace expressed in His kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared for us in advance for us to do. And the thing is, right up until that last sentence, everything sort of is all going in one direction, which is, you know, it's all about grace, it's all about faith, it's not about works, that's not the issue. God is saving you through grace and because of your faith. And then we get to that last sentence and Paul says, yeah, but it's about works too. The whole reason that you've been saved is so you can go do good stuff. Works. And we think, well, that seems a bit confusing, doesn't it? You know, we're not saved by works, we're just built for works, you know. That's not really confusing. I mean, it is confusing in a sense, but it's not really a contradiction. It just kind of seems like one. There's a difference between being saved by something and being made for something. And so we are not saved by the things that we do, but we are built as Christians to do good things that God wants us to do. And one of the words that's used to describe this is fruit. That Christians are made to produce fruit. And it's kind of interesting because if you go to that Hebrews passage that we were looking at that I kind of started this off with where it says it's impossible to please God without faith, if you look at the Hebrews passage, it's basically a recounting of great men of faith and the thing or women of faith as well and the different things that they did, that the faith that they showed. And an archetype of this, the very first one is Abel. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 5, it says, by faith Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained the testimony that he was righteous, God testifying about his gifts, and through faith, though he is dead, he still speaks. So you notice here that when it says Abel was a man of faith, the reason we know that Abel was a man of faith is because he offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain. That's a doing thing. Now, it doesn't say that that was what saved him. It says that his faith caused him to offer a better sacrifice. And he was rewarded for his behavior, for his conduct, by God testifying about him. So we see this pattern, and you see it over and over again. It says, you know, Noah built an ark, and God saved him and his family. Abraham went where God told him to, and he obtained the promises. And it goes on through all these different people of faith, each one of whom did something or a number of different somethings and was rewarded as a result. So they had faith, saving faith, but it caused them to do things that God wanted them to do. And in doing those things, they obtained even more than what they had gotten just through the faith at its most basic. And James talks about this, the problem of faith that doesn't have anything backing it up. In James chapter 2, he says, "What use is it, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but has no works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is without clothing and in need of daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, be warmed and filled,' and yet you do not give them what is necessary for their body, what use is that? Even so, faith, if it has no works, is dead, being by itself." In other words, what he says is, if your faith, or what you call your faith, doesn't lead you to produce those good works that Paul says you were built for, then you don't have real faith. You don't have saving faith. You've got something else, something less than that. James continues, he says, "But someone may well say, 'You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without the works, and I will show you my faith by my works.'" And that's kind of that's a reality, you know. When you go and you say to somebody, "This is what I believe," and then you don't do anything that seems to line up with that, they kind of question if that's really what you believe. But when you see people doing what they say they believe, it's real easy to say, yeah, they actually believe that, because what they do lines up with what they say. Do as I say, not as I do. We want to be able to say, do as I say and as I do, you know. James continues, he says, "You believe that God is one. You do well. The demons also believe and shudder. But are you willing to recognize, you foolish fellow, that faith without works is useless? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up Isaac his son on the altar?" I want us to see there's two different kinds of faith that he's talking about here. One is, he says, the demons also believe and shudder. The demons believe in God, but it doesn't have any impact on how they behave. Their faith is disconnected from their actions. Their faith is a real faith. It's a real belief in the existence of God, but it's an intellectual belief. It's not an acting belief. By contrast, so when it's just belief, it's dead. And by the same token, if it's just faith without any works, it's dead. Abraham is justified by works because he offered Isaac on the altar. You see that faith was working with his works, and as a result of the works, faith was perfected. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, "And Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness, and he was called the friend of God." I think that phrase there, "faith was perfected," is kind of the key. We want that kind of faith. Not perfect faith in the sense that we never waver, but faith that's perfected in what we do. What I call living faith, faith that's alive and not just dead. He says, "You see that a man is justified by works, not faith alone. In the same way was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messenger and sent them out by another way? So just as the body without the spirit is dead, so also faith without works is dead." This seems, at first glance, it kind of seems like James and Paul are arguing at cross purposes. Paul is saying you're not saved by anything but faith. Faith, works do not have anything to do with it. Works are not what saves you. And James is saying you're only saved by faith if leads to works. If you're doing something, the works are what justifies you. But I think ultimately we reconcile them in that notion that we were created to do good works. And so faith is what saves us because of that grace response, or that response to grace. But faith is meaningless. Faith isn't real if it doesn't lead us to do something, if we're not responding to that faith with action. And so you can be believing in God intellectually. Lots of people believe in God intellectually, but if it doesn't impact the way you act, if it doesn't make any difference in your life, it's a dead faith. And we want a living faith. We want a faith that causes us to act, causes us to obey, causes us to respond. In Colossians, Paul refers to this as show giving fruit. He says, for this reason also, since the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritualism and understanding, that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects. We pray that you may bear fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the sons of light. So notice here, this is the same guy who said, you're saved by faith, not by works. But then he says, we are praying that you will walk in a worthy manner. We are praying that you will bear fruit in every good work. We're praying that you will do things because of your faith. So faith causes us to do things. But then the last part of this, where I want to finish at, is when he says, our Father has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. So finally, I want to finish with the idea of the inheritance of faith. The inheritance of faith. The Jews believed that they were the heirs of faith, the heirs of Moses, of Abraham. They believed that their relationship to God would save them, maybe not even so much because of their faith, but simply because of their relationship by blood to Abraham. They believed in that, and yet, during the time of Jesus, there were so many things that are going wrong for the Jews. And we've talked before about the political things and the rule by the Romans and everything like that. But there were also a lot of localized things that were going wrong. There was a lot of suffering. There was a lot of demon possession. There was a lot of just really bad stuff happening. And in Mark chapter 9, we see an example of that, where a man in the crowd says to Jesus, "Teacher, I brought you my son possessed with a spirit which makes him mute. And whenever it seizes him, it slams him to the ground, and he foams at the mouth, and he grinds his teeth and stiffens out." Can you imagine that happening to your child? You know, and not having any medical explanation for it, any way to understand that? The man says, "I told your disciples to cast it out, and they could not do it." And he answered them and said, "O unbelieving generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring him to me." And they brought the boy to him, and when he saw him, immediately the spirit threw him into a convulsion, and falling to the ground, he began rolling around and foaming at the mouth. And he asked his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. It has often thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him." That's horrifying, that this spirit is just tormenting this kid. And then the father says, "But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." See, this guy's faith isn't quite where Jairus' faith was. Jairus said, "Come and heal my daughter." There's no question he can do it. This guy says, "If you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." And Jesus says to him, "If you can," you can hear almost the sarcasm in his voice, "if you can, all things are possible to him who believes." Of course I can, but do you believe I can? Do you have faith that I can? And Jesus said, oh, sorry, there it is again. And immediately it says, the boy's father cried out and said, "I do believe, help my unbelief." So the man recognized that his faith was lacking, that it wasn't what it could be. He was one of the Jews who believed he was the heir of Abraham, who believed that he had the rights to the promises that had been promised all those many years ago to Abraham, and even further back than that. And yet he recognized that in this moment, when he was face to face with someone who could actually do the kinds of things that were promised, that his faith wasn't quite up to what it needed to be. And he recognized that the only place you get more faith is from God. But that faith in God, that leads to an inheritance, it ties you into something bigger. And this guy got a glimpse of that when Jesus healed his son. We get more than a glimpse of that because of the scriptures and what it teaches us about who we are and what faith does in our lives. And in Paul's mind, that's the core to how we live as Christians, because it's a reminder constantly that if we have faith in God, we know that this world is not the end of what happens. This world is not the end of what's important. In fact, it's not even really the beginning of what's important, other than the choices that we make here. The really important stuff happens afterwards. In 2 Corinthians 5, Paul says, "Now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, We have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, because when we are clothed, we will no longer be found naked. The contrast here is not to say that we are literally running around naked. The idea is a spiritual clothing. What we've got right now is something that's spiritually not much. It's spiritually uncovered. Our spiritual raiment, our garb is tattered and worn and damaged, and it's not what we want to have. There's something better, something perfect that's waiting for us in heaven. We're waiting to be clothed and have that replace us, replace the broken and damaged spiritual clothing that we have now, so that we will not be found naked. He continues, he says, for while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. See, everything that's wrong with you is a part of your mortality. Everything that's wrong with me is part of my mortality. It's not just about the fact that we're dying. It's the failed parts of our humanity, the sinful nature that we have, the desire that we have to go do bad things that find us attracted to bad stuff. That is part of our mortality. And once our mortality is swallowed up by life, by God's life, it doesn't bother us anymore. It's not part of us anymore. It's taken away. Paul says, now it is God who has made us for this very purpose and has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. Paul says we have faith that God's deposit of the Holy Spirit is proof, is evidence to us that shows us that we do have a future with God, that this world is not the end, that we are intended for something better. And our faith tells us that we can trust in that, that we can focus beyond this life into the next life, because Paul says we walk by faith, not by sight. We don't live in this world and operate in this world based on what we see around us. Obviously we do when we're driving a car, when we're walking, but those aren't the important things. As Christians, we operate in this world by faith, understanding that what's happening in the other realms around us, in the eternity around us, is more important for our souls than anything that can happen to us in this lifetime. Understanding that the choices we make in this life are important only to the extent that they have an effect on our eternal destiny. And we do that because we have faith, and because faith is what is driving us and not just what we see with our eyes and hear with our ears. That the best things and the most important things come from faith. And so for Christians, as I said at the beginning, faith is the core of our identity. You can't please God without faith. You can't even begin to understand God without faith. You're certainly not going to be able to do what He wants without faith. So what we're going to be talking about, this is the necessity for the starting point, because ultimately faith has two branches. There is the faith that drives what we believe in, which I would call doctrine, I guess, for lack of a better word. And there is the faith that drives what we do, which is our practices, which is our behaviors. And so in the coming weeks, we're going to look at both of those. We're going to start down, I haven't decided yet which one of those two branches we're going to go down first. We're going to spend some time on both of them, because when it comes to the question of what is a Christian supposed to be, what is a Christian supposed to believe, those are the two branches at the center of it. But none of it works without faith. Because if you don't have faith, you're just like the Pharisees. You can believe in whatever you want to. And you can do whatever you want to, and they can be the best, nicest, I almost said goodest things that you can do, but they're not going to mean anything. It only means anything if we walk by faith and not by sight. Let's stand and sing.
We know the promises, time is the word, dearer far than any message man ever heard. Your was the mind of Christ, sinless I see. He's a great example, is a pattern for me. Where he leads a follow, 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 Sweet is the tender love Jesus has shown, sweeter far than any love that mortals have known. Kind to the erring one, faithful is he. He the great example is a pattern for me. Jesus every day.